HarperCollins presents Otter's Moon by Susanna Bailey. Read by Robin Laing. 1. When we came to the island, it was summer. But summer stayed behind on the mainland. There's a chill in the air here. The sort of chill that runs through you when something is about to happen. Something bad. We have had blue skies, the kind of blue skies a little kid would paint, only without the yellow sun in the corner. If we see the sun at all, it's pale and half-hearted, like it doesn't want to be here either. I was kind of looking forward to all the fresh air and outdoor stuff Mum kept on about when she sold me this Scottish island holiday. When she said the house was a stone's throw from the beach, I saw rolling waves. Warm golden sand. Kids that would be made up to have a boy from London come and liven up their boring island life. Well, true, the house is near the beach. It's all by itself on the cliff top overlooking the bay. But the sand here is malevolent, full of tiny sharp edges to cut your feet. And it's more grey than golden. The sea stings your eyes. And it's too still, like it's holding its breath, waiting. As for the local kids, they're not interested in making friends. They just nudge one another and look away when they see me coming, or whisper behind their hands. Not the kind of whispering the girls back at school go in for, this is different. It's like they know something, something I need to know too. But yesterday, I did meet a girl with something to say. She's sitting on the patchy grass outside our fence, staring out to sea and flicking pebbles over the edge of the cliff. I risk a, "Hello." She carries on throwing and staring. I stand there, scuffing at the grass with the toe of my trainer, wondering whether she heard me over the whine of the wind. Whether to try again. Wondering why she's here, and whether she's in need of company too. My throat feels dry. She's probably just another unsociable islander. I could look pretty stupid here. I pick up a white pebble, weigh it in my palm, decide to give her the benefit of the doubt. I've had enough of one-way conversations with seabirds. I sit down next to her and join in. Must be 10 minutes and 20 pebbles before she speaks. "You're him then? At Cliff House?" She screws up her eyes like there's bright sun only she can see. I nod. 10 days on this island, and I'm as tongue-tied as everyone else round here. Another 5 pebbles worth of silence. "I'm Megan. Meg." Her pale hair lifts in the breeze. She pulls a strand of it into her mouth, tilts her head to look at me from under her fringe, points to the left side of the beach below us. "That's my house, down there."
"Where?"
I peer over her shoulder.
"The boathouse."
"You live there? But it's all boarded up." She looks at me again, a pebble poised in her hand.
"Grandad said a boy was poking around yesterday."
I think of the old man I saw down on the shore, bent and thin as driftwood, his hair bleached and dry like the grass among the dunes. I had noticed his eyes as I passed, still as the sea and blue, bright, vivid blue.
"I wasn't poking around,"
I say.
"I was looking around, looking for something interesting to do. Not that I've found anything."
Meg stands up.
"I have to go,"
she says. She brushes sand and dead grass from her jeans.
"Don't come by our house again, okay?"
"What exactly is your problem, you and everyone else in this place? Against the local religion to be friendly, is it?"
"Just don't come by," she says, and grabs my arm. I'll come for you, okay? I'll come for you.
What makes you think I want you to? I mutter, as she walks away.
You do,
she calls without looking back. I flick my last pebble over the cliff and watch it fall. 2. Today I am out of the house getting sea air in my lungs. Apparently this is just what I need. At 9 in the morning. Apparently it's not what Mum needs. She hasn't left the house in 2 weeks now. Except to nip to the shop. The shop. The only shop. But she doesn't even want to do that today. Still, at least that's an hour of my day sorted, getting eggs and beans. Another 10 to go before it's dark enough to go to sleep. It gets dark early here, even in summer. The shop is some sort of converted chapel with arched windows. One of them has a crack from top to bottom. Its yellowing glass is crisscrossed with tape. The other is jammed full of stuff. What you might call a no-effort window display. Tins of fruit that look like they've been there since the war. A stack of Tom Piper tinned steak. Tinned steak? Bottles of cod liver oil. There's someone suspiciously like Captain Birdseye on the label. He has a pipe in his mouth, and he's puffing a massive cloud of smoke while looking smug about the health-sustaining properties of cod liver oil. There's a pyramid stack of boxed humane mouse traps in one corner. The whole thing's covered in cobwebs. Either there are no mice here, or the islanders don't go in for the humane approach. Inside the shop, ropes hang like coiled snakes from the walls, and there are huge baskets of logs, buckets of coal, jet black and glistening, sacks of green apples and potatoes. Most of them are green too. I find beans, a brand I recognise, thank God. I choose 6 speckled brown eggs from a blue bowl on the counter. A curled feather is stuck to one of them. I pull it off, blow it into the air, watch it drift from side to side, then disappear, lost among the apples. I wonder for the first time whether hens get upset when their eggs are taken away.
You buying those things, young man?
A sharp voice from nowhere. I almost drop the eggs. Look round. See no one.
Yes, sorry, just these, please.
I put my purchases on the counter, quickly followed by money. The shopkeeper is younger than his voice, and, weirdly, dressed in a suit and tie. His hair is black, and too shiny, like it's painted on. He holds out what my mum would call artistic hands, long fingers, shiny nails.
Thank you,
he says. He disappears under the counter, reappears with a battered tin box, produces my change. No till, then. My mum's brought me to some kind of lost world.
Don't suppose you know where I can get a decent phone signal?
I ask from the doorway. The shopkeeper looks up, pen in hand, looks down, continues writing.
That'll be a no, then, I mutter.
Mum's up and dressed when I get back, which is great. She eats breakfast with me, which is even better. She hasn't been hungry until dinner time since we arrived here. And even then, she pushes her food around her plate like it's something suspicious, slides most of it into the bin if she can.
Leave the dishes for now, she says. I'm going down to the beach. Thought I might try out my new camera. Come with me?
Okay, I say, wondering what I'll find to do down there.
Great.
The wind's dropped when we get to the beach. That stillness again. Like walking onto a film set.
Those old boats, see? Over there.
Mum points to the edge of the dunes, close to Meg's boathouse.
I noticed them when we got here, covered in barnacles, great colours.
Think I'll start with those.
I nod, smile.
Brilliant,
I say.
Take as long as you like, Mum.
Maybe she was right. Maybe this break will be good for her. Help get over Dad. Help with whatever made her sad when he was still around. Maybe.
A seagull lifts from one of the upturned hulls, gives a loud squawk of protest at our intrusion. For a moment, it looks like he's flying straight at us, but he swoops away, circles to the left and disappears. I sit with Mum for a while. Listen to the whir of her lenses, the click of the shutter. Sounds I haven't heard for months. There's a leap of something light in my stomach. I think of her bent over her laptop, engrossed in her images, hair glinting in the firelight, while Dad and I stick pieces of model aircraft to our fingers. Somehow Dad always made the aircraft turn out okay, even though there was always one piece missing, and he always got round Mum about the glue on the carpet, always made her laugh. That's another sound I haven't heard in a while. We walk back to the cottage when we're hungry, have sandwiches and hot chocolate for lunch. Mum asks if I mind another trip to the beach when we're done. And I don't, even though it's boring down there. It's no more boring than everywhere else on this island. And when Mum gets up to clear the table, she moves just a bit more like herself. I'll take being bored, just to see that. I help. Put our leftovers in a bag for the birds. Not that I've seen any birds other than the seagulls. And I'm not sure about encouraging them. On the walk back to the beach, I ask when Dad's coming to see me. Mum doesn't know. He's busy, she tells me. But he'll come soon. He misses me. Right, I say, wondering about the evidence for that. I push the wondering away. There's no phone signal on this stupid island, I shout. Dad can't even ring me. I kick at the rough grass under our feet. Is that why you brought me here, to get back at him? I didn't know I was going to say that. Luke, we talked about this. You talked about it, I say. Mum stops, looks right at me. Her cheeks are pale again. Sorry, I say. I look away. Me too, Mum says. She shakes her head slowly, sighs, like she's sorry about a whole lot of things. It takes ages to get back to the boats. My feet keep sinking in the sand. The seagull is there again, perched on one of the upturned hulls. It keeps its round black eyes fixed on me, follows my every move. Mum wanders up and down the sand for an hour, lifts and drops her camera, gazes out to sea. She doesn't take any more pictures in the end. She blames the light. Not enough of it now, too many shadows. We go back to the cottage, and this evening she's too tired to eat dinner. When she goes to bed, I pick up her camera, look for the shots she took that morning. There's nothing. She's wiped them all. My fault. I punctured the day. 3. Next morning, Mum's still in bed at 11 a.m. I take her tea, then coffee and toast, but she's not hungry. Back to square one. Good job, Luke. Don't worry about me, she says. Go off and enjoy yourself. Tricky. On both counts. I'll give it a go, I say. I offer her the best fake smile I can find. Hope she'll notice it doesn't reach my eyes and ask me why. She doesn't. She just smiles back, nods, shifts further down into her bed. I hover, wait for her to ask where I'm going, what time I'll be home, whether I've got water and sunscreen and snacks. She doesn't do that either. I'll see you later then, I say.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.